It's a very hot topic at the moment. I talk about this almost every day. A lot of CIOs in the Netherlands are struggling with this thing. And I'm going to explain to you in my presentation a bit why they are struggling with this and also what you can do to make things better. Let's put it like that. I had myself also introducing myself a bit in this slide, but I already was introduced, so I can skip most of this part. Maybe a good thing to know is that I'm not living in Amsterdam, but in Veendam, which is surprisingly far away from Amsterdam. It's almost in Germany, even almost in Denmark, in the north of the Netherlands. And next to my job in Metri, I do a lot of stuff also in NESMA, ICBC, but also in COSMIC and ICEA, which is the International Cost Estimation and Analysis Association. Basically, NESMA, we have a functional size standard, but it's nowadays more of a global organization moving into software cost estimation type of activities. Please connect with me. You can see also here my LinkedIn name and everything, so we can share professional ideas if you like. All right, so I'm going to talk about performance measurement today. Performance measurement, what is it? It's basically looking at what's happening. You want to do things fast, you want to do things right, you want to do things on time, and you want to keep doing things. These are on kind of every level in organizations, the things that you would like to know on the team level, but also on the organization level and on the IT department level, all kinds of levels. But of course you need metrics and KPIs to measure, to understand what's going on and to change things if necessary. If we look at agile versus traditional, so in the old days, let's say before 2010, a lot of organizations were still in the traditional paradigm, which is on the left here, where you see we have a plan-driven approach. So we have first analysis, business analysis, then we have some information analysis, then we have functional design, we have technical design, and then we're going to develop and in the end implement the system, which was usually too late and too expensive, and by then the whole world was changed and the functionality once thought of was not longer the thing that people wanted. And in those days, so you had to fix scope, you had to estimate the cost and estimate the time, and quality was kind of implied. But now we're in an agile world, so we just turned the whole pyramid around. We say, okay, we don't have to estimate the cost and the time anymore because they're fixed, because I have a team of a certain number of people, and they just start working and deliver value, the most important value first. And so at the end, you don't have to really estimate the cost anymore, but you have to estimate the value or at least the features and when are the features going to be ready. So it's a bit different. But that's a very important thing that has changed in the industry. So if you look at the typical agile, in this case, a Scrum process, you have on the left, you have a product backlog. So there's a product owner who kind of manages the product backlog, puts stories there. Then there's a sprint backlog, and the sprint backlog is filled every sprint with the features or the stories that are most important or at that moment that needs to be delivered. Then you have the Scrum team that is delivering, that's working on those sprint backlog items, and who's going to implement something that is workable, that works after the 2 weeks. So in theory, every 2 weeks you get new value. As a business or as a user, you will get something new. And like I said, okay, so you don't really have to calculate the cost anymore because you have a number of people in the team. sprint last 2 weeks, and you know how many hours are going to be spent, you know the hourly rate of the people. So you can really easily calculate the sprint cost. And of course, yeah, someone can be on a vacation or sick, or it can be small deviations, but at least it should be somewhere here in this region. But okay, so now the question is, what is the value that is planned for a certain sprint? Because of course the product owner is responsible for this, and there's the whole business or user community who is waiting for the value, or at least maybe they're not waiting for it, but there should be value, and there is cost, so something should come out of it as well. And the value delivered is of course very important, and there's sometimes a difference between the value planned and the value delivered. Now, if we look at, and that was an example of one team. If we look at the whole organization, IT organization, you can see here the SAFe framework, one of the pictures of the SAFe framework. You see on various levels, there is a lot of process going on. You know, on the down level, you have the development team who are going to be developing in a certain cadence and in the way I just showed you. But on a higher level, there are also things that need to be understood. So for instance, on the portfolio level, you have epics, and you have a certain idea in the future when certain functionality should be ready because of, for instance, regulations. Or marketing campaigns that are going to start, and all these type of things, you have to make sure that the teams on the lower level are going to deliver the right functionality when it is necessary to get it. And if you don't have, let's say, the plan-driven approach, so you don't know exactly what you're going to make, what you're going to deliver, but you and you embrace change over following a plan, which is agile philosophy, then there's a bit of a difficult situation that on a higher level, it's hard to get grip on what is happening on the lower level, especially if you have a lot of teams. But you need it because you have to show it to your stakeholders. You have to align with the business people. And if you look here, you should also have metrics, even in this SAFe, the Skilled Agile Framework Enterprise, which I show here. And you have KPIs. So you need some way of understanding what's going on. But if you look at the SAFe metrics, these are kind of official metrics that are proposed by this framework. You see things like, okay, for productivity, we use feature cycle time. For time to market, we use the number of releases per year and defect data and support call volume. For functionality, velocity plan, velocity actual. But these are usually measured in story points, which are not standardized and also not a measure for value or for functionality. Because I recently did a study measuring a team, and they even put story points on creating an acceptance test environment and stuff like that. Yeah, okay, it's working, but it's a task, it's not a story. So if you use metrics like these, which are not standardized, number of stories planned and accepted, etc. Okay, but what does it say? If a story can also be create an acceptance test environment, which of course for the user or the business does not add value to the product. And then these type of metrics, of course, they may be very relevant and very interesting to see, but they don't give the grip on the teams and they don't. Even if you want to measure trends, you can't really see improvement of the process or of the productivity or things like that if you measure these type of metrics. So if you look at teams and business value, because that's in the end, of course, the holy grail. Everyone wants to understand how much value will I get. And you see the team is usually working the first sprint. They can work on new functionality, but only after that, things will already change, because the product owner will say, hey, I see this screen, it looks good, but I want this field to be there. I want this button to be green instead of red, etc. So you will have modified and even deleted functionality for some things that you may not like or decides that it should not be there. And already there, maybe there are some refactoring of the code because, yeah, in the first sprint, we had to do a little shortcut. We had to make something, put something there just to get the sprint done in time. But we have to fix that. And then you have some refactoring of the code, which is obviously not adding to the value. Okay, you have to do it for your maintenance or for your hygiene. But in the end, that doesn't deliver the extra value to the business. And then, okay, you go on your new sprints. You get to a minimal viable product, which is usually the something basic that works and that shows brings value. And you see there is also bug fixing there because at some time, bugs get created and they need to be fixed. And after go live, you even get maybe sometimes some other stuff in there, like the third line support when there are real incidents for the customers as well. So, but you can see here that through time, if you're not managing this properly, it can be that while you think on a higher level, okay, I have my team, they're producing value. In the end, a lot of stuff that may be valuable, but that don't bring visible value to the organization, to the business, to the customers. And this may be a problem because if your estimate at first was based on let's say the functionality that you get here, which is shown in the first sprint or the next sprint, even. But in the end, you end up with teams that produce very little new functionality. Then your plan on a higher level or in the long term may be at risk. Well, next comes in functional size. Of course, we are a lot of people here know about functional size. It's an independent standard, objective, repeatable, comparable, verifiable. It's easy to use, especially let's say the high level methods. Roberto is probably going to talk about simple function points. Also the high level methods of NESMA, they are very simple to use. For instance, if you have only a data model or just an idea about which objects are going to be there, you can already use it. But especially for agile teams, it should be so easy to use functional size, because they have sprints of only 2 or 3 weeks. So how much functional size will be there to make? So in the old days, it was always said, functional size measurement takes a long time. Because at that in those times, there were like projects of 3,000, 4,000, 5,000, 10,000 function points. Then it takes a long time to measure it manually. But now, if you just have a couple of stories to build, or you have built it in the last sprint, it's quite easy to do a function point analysis because it takes maybe an hour, and then you have objective measure of the size that was produced with the functionality, which is value. Usually it should be value, otherwise you shouldn't deliver it. And there's the big difference also, like I said before, with the story point velocity metrics. So there are a couple of standards out there. You see here IFPUG, NESMA, COSMIC, there are also OMG, there's an automated function point measurement standard. And if you look at what should be the key performance metrics for agile teams, it's productivity. You see here the effort hours spent divided by the size. This is this is theoretically not right, because productivity is universally defined as output divided by input, no, the other way around, and we changed it here because of otherwise you get very small numbers. You get like 0.012 function points per hour, which is difficult for the human brain to understand. So productivity in this context is like the project delivery rate that we have in ISBSG. I use those terms like they're the same. So project delivery rate is what we use in ISBSG. Is the number of effort hours spent divided by the size. Cost efficiency is the team cost divided by the size of the value delivered. Delivery speed says something about how much value is delivered per month. And this is close to the velocity metric that is used in Agile a lot, which is usually story points per sprint or story points per month. But in this case, of course, it's objective measurement with function points. And then we look at product quality, which is defect delivered. It should be project quality, actually. It says wrong here. And the product quality is defined by a lot of static code metrics that you can measure with all kinds of tools, which is important to do because I do a lot of Agile team performance measurement projects where I measure a lot of teams. You can see some teams are very productive, especially if they use Kanban. They can be very productive, but usually the code quality is very low. And if your code quality is low, then there is another problem because that will add up to the cost of the maintenance. And also you will get extra incidents in production. So unhappy users, unhappy business, and also people that could even harm the business in the financial way. So code quality and team performance go hand in hand. They should both be good and improving, I would say. So if you look at this pyramid again, this is the Agile pyramid. You can see that actually even the guys on the top level that need to understand what's going on the lower level, they can have everything in place to really understand what's going on, because we this standardized metrics that we have they cover everything that's here in this pyramid. So it is possible to have per team, but also on the portfolio level, an exact understanding of what is going on, which improves the predictability in an enormous way also. If we look at the market, so in Metri we are a benchmarking consultancy and a sourcing consultancy organization. By the way, we were acquired this year by IDC, which is International Research Organization. So we are now not longer a Dutch company, we're also an international company. But we do a lot of research on Agile team performance, and you see here the metrics that we usually use, and I already introduced them. So we have team metrics, we have product metrics, and we see enormous differences in the market when it comes to performance of teams. But also of the quality of the applications. This is very, it's not strange, so it's a bit strange, but what we see also in the market is that a lot of organizations that hire, for instance, external support or external people or external teams even, they don't understand that this is happening. So there is a factor, maybe 10 difference in productivity of people, of teams. And still in the industry, hiring teams, for instance, is an hourly rate by business. So if you just hire a guy who is 80 euro per hour, a senior developer, or instead of 190 euro per hour, then that's considered to be a good deal, while the difference in productivity can be 10 times. So it's still a lot of work out there just to get those people to understand you can have productivity metrics, you can have cost efficiency metrics, And work with that also in context, also in all kinds of contexts. So once you measure the performance of teams, you start also to understand through time what's going on. So you have your metrics and you have your trends. And the extra value that ISBSG is bringing is that we are able to put the blue line here. Because that's the benchmark, and the benchmark is market average, or for some customers we have to use the P25, the best 25% of the market, you can pick any other percentile. But in the ISBSG data, of course, there's over 10,000 points at the moment. You can select the data set, and I will show you in a minute how that can be done. And you can determine what is the market average for your particular situation. Let's say you have an agile team working on a Java system, which is about 500 function points at the moment. And you have you're working in, for instance, the banking sector. So a number of these characteristics you can just use to filter the data and then select your own data set and understand what is the market average for your type of situation. And that's very valuable, because that could be the target. Say, okay, at the moment in this example you see here on my screen, maybe it's now January 2018 and my productivity is 16 hours per function point, but I want to go to 10 because that's the market average, and that's should be realistic for our company. So you can measure that over time and see if you're improving, and understand what's happening. And if not improving, then maybe you should do things different, because it is possible. The market data shows that it is possible. So you're doing something wrong, what others are doing right. So this type of understanding you get once you are able to put the blue line there, to put the benchmark there. But how do you do that? Okay, I'm going to show you. So you see here an Excel file on the bottom of the screen. When you subscribe to the data, license data, you get an Excel file with these 10,000 plus projects, and there are just basically rows in an Excel file. And you see here on top, you see the columns. There are over 250 columns, which are data attributes. Every project has an ID. It is put there by the repository manager. Data quality and UFP rating, it says something about how confident are we that the function point count or the sizing has done correctly. It's important part, of course, because if your functional size is not good, then the data will also not be good. And then we have a lot of attributes like the industry, sector, organization type, application group, application type, development type, etc. And of course, primary programming language is a very important one, because there are really big differences between technologies when it comes to, for instance, productivity. It's important that every data source is it's all anonymous. Also, if you submit your projects and get your free benchmark report, like Paula just mentioned, it will always be stored in our database, in our repository, anonymously, to make sure that nobody can trace it back to your organization, which is of course important fact. But more important is that, of course, Excel is a very, very good tool for data analysis. And if you want to analyze your data, you can put filters there, you can make pivot tables, you can do all kinds of stuff, which I'll show you in a minute. And just to easily understand your peer group that you want to compare to. Just for a bit of more information, I took some screenshots of the data. You can see here that we have functional size. Of course, the functional size, you always have to understand which method was used to determine the functional size. We have the relative size, which is a method that at ISBSG we use just to characterize the functional size into put them into buckets, let's say extra large, small, it's like t-shirt sizing, which is a bit easier also if you want just to select a certain size range and analyze that one. So effort is also important, of course. We have a couple of different levels. Usually we use level one, which is development team only. And then the metrics are calculated, metrics that you can see here as well. So the PDR is like the productivity, like I said, this is the number of hours per function point. Defect density is number of defects per function point, speed of delivery, number of function points per month. And then you have the manpower delivery rate. That says something about how many people were used to deliver it. Then another screenshot about effort that is collected. You can also see here that not always there is all cells are filled. But in the end, if not all the phases are supplied, there is still a way to use it because we have our repository manager then normalizing the data, and there's a normalized effort field as well. So and with all this information, and there's much more, like I said, there's like 250 columns, but with this information that I just showed you, it's already possible to measure these core agile metrics. Once you have calculated those metrics, it becomes possible to do your analysis. And I just want to show you here an example of what I always do with the ISBSG data. So I have here the columns A, B, C, and D. They have a color. And what I do is just go into the data set, do my filtering, then copy all the cells that are there after the filtering. I copy them here as values. The PDR in A, column A, the cost efficiency in column B, etc. And then I'll be able to put this table here where I put the simple formulas there to do your basic analysis of the data. And you see here that there's the number, there's the minimum, there's the maximum, there's all kinds of percentiles and the median, the average. The percentile, of course, says something about the P10 is the 10% best values in that column. It shows the number 10 percentile. And this is a very easy way just to make all kinds of analysis. And sometimes, okay, you want to have something which is not there yet in the ISBC database. For instance, in this case, the cost per function point is not there, but you can calculate it because there's cost and there are function points. But sometimes the cost, you have to be a bit careful there because cost may be more than just the cost of the effort hours. And you should understand exactly what is the cost. But you can do this type of analysis. And then, you can get this type of table where you can just understand. Oh, okay, my median, which is I use usually for the average, let's say the peer average or the benchmark, the median value, because most of this effort is of this data is usually skewed to the right, so the average may be way off from the median. If average and median are almost the same, then usually you have kind of a well distributed distribution. And you see here also if you don't filter out the outliers, you get maybe some outliers like here. You have to be between the P90 and the max. There's usually a little wide gap. It's very steep. But that doesn't matter because if you use the median and for instance the P30 or and the P70 for the peer low and the peer high, you can still have there's no real impact of those outliers. And then you can use it, of course, for also for estimation, which we also do a lot. If you have these values and you estimate the number of function points or your backlog, which is possible, like I said in the beginning, even if you have a very crude backlog, for instance, indicative NESMA function point analysis, it's a very easy way to get an idea how big the backlog is. And of course, the backlog changes all the time, but at least at that moment, you can already understand if your team that is working to create something is big enough to create it in time. It should be ready at some point in time. Or maybe you need two teams, maybe even three. So then you already understand, okay, I have to make this amount of functionality. I know we're going to have changes also because, yeah, it's agile, so things will change. I will get the team, the code refactoring, I will get the bug fixing, I will get the rework, etc. So you have to factor in all those type of things, of course. But that is in also the data that we have here, because that has happened in the past as well. And therefore, these type of productivity rates can help very well just to make this type of calculation. So with this, I come to my conclusions of my presentation. It's basically that I started with the story that a lot of people, a lot of CIOs are struggling with this, the grip on their teams. Once they go to agile, they don't get the management information anymore, what's going on. A lot of things are changing on a lower level. You need, at some point, you need to understand what's going on. You have to make decisions if things are not going right. You want to show to your stakeholders that things are improving. You want to get grip on the whole situation. And what I hopefully have demonstrated in this presentation, that is possible, but you need objective metrics. You need objective metrics which you can measure in a quite easy manner with functional sizing, but you have to do it, and you have to do it consistently, and you have to do it in a standardized way, and preferably, you can do it, you can have it done by a team, but it's better if the product owner does it, because he is kind of, not really part of the team, and more objective. That would be, I hope, your takeaway from this presentation is that it is possible to get grip on those teams. Benchmarking adds a lot of value to these type of metrics because it sets targets and you understand where is your room for improvement. And I showed you how to do it in an easy way, make your own analysis using the ISBHT data. If you are interested in getting the ISBHT data, it's quite easy to obtain it on the website. You have the tab subscriptions. You can go there, also see what it is. For instance, to be a corporate subscriber, which is gives more value even. Or you can just, because first a NESMA member or any other of the gold partners, and you get a discount like Paula already showed before. And of course, the value of being a member of NESMA or any other gold partner. So I guess this was it for me. I think my presentation is done. I'm curious if there are any questions.
Thanks a lot, Harold. Very interesting to hear. And it's a hot topic. And I've been involved in that as well when I've been working as a benchmarking consultant. Let's see here. We had some questions coming up. From Ria Bacciani. It said under slide 15, there are categorized done for functional size, t-shirt size. And can you please to elaborate a little bit about how the categories are, let's see, we said jumped away here.
I'm still sharing my screen, right?
Yeah.
So this t-shirt size, it's a method of ISBC repository manager to put any project in a certain size bucket. So we have, I think we have XXS, which you also see here on the screen. 8 function points is in that category until XXL, I think. And there are like categories from 0 to 10, 10 to 50, 50 to 100, 100 to 300. I'm not completely sure if those are the right numbers, but it's that type of system. And that makes it possible, for instance, because it's different, of course, if you have to, for instance, estimate a new project to work on the application, which is already 10,000 function points big, compared to if you start working on that when it's only 100 function points big. Because the 10,000 thing will be much harder to change anything than the 100 point thing. So it helps you with selecting the right data set for your analysis.
I fully agree. I was working with the same way. We had thresholds for different sizes. Mm-hmm. So then we had one question from Roberto Mele, one of the presenters today. He asked you, could you clarify if cost means internal costs or market unitary prices?
Yeah, I think here in ISBSG, we collect the cost of the cost of the project. And I don't think that we collect if it's internal or external cost. But it could be, because we have many, many different columns, but I don't think that is the level of detail we get.
Yeah, and then we have a question from Thomas Fellman in Switzerland. Do you measure sprint performance?
Yeah, you can do that, but in sprints, many times in sprints, things are not implemented, even though in theory, you should have after the sprint software that is workable. In practice, you see a lot that there are still releases, let's say every 2 months or 3 months that there is a release. So only then there will be a lot of focus on testing still. So if you measure the sprint performance, you will see sometimes a bit of erratic behavior of the trends. You can do it if you for a longer time, because the trends will still be there, but you will see from sprint to sprint, you will see spikes but it's possible we sometimes do it.
Then we had a clarification from Paula, and she says that the t-shirt size, you can find that on the demographics report that is based on the data we have in the repository on page 10. That is, so you can download it free, this demographics report. And then let's see, we have more questions here. Question, does ISBC have a paper if all categories items present in ISB and metric benchmarking?
Sorry, I don't understand the question. Can you repeat, please?
No. It says, do ISBSG have a paper if all categories/items present in ISBC and metric benchmarking? I don't understand fully. Marcelo, could
meant to say of. Do ISBSG have a paper of all categories items presented in ISBSG and metric benchmarking? So in various reports, but I'm not sure about what's in metri benchmarking. Maybe Harold, is there anything else in metri benchmarking that's not in ISBSG?
So the code quality metrics that we add to our benchmarks, the ones I showed you, the security or robustness, those type of things, And we have a paper about it, by the way, on the www.metrigroup.com website. We have a paper about productivity measurement of agile teams, and there it is exactly explained what is in the in that type of benchmark.
And there is also a paper both on NESMA website and IFPUG websites about agile and what you should think about that and take in consideration when doing software measurement. Mm-hmm. Let's see if we have any more questions. No, I think that was all questions that we had.
There's one more.
Okay.
Gianfranco, do you use the data in contracts?
Yeah, that's came up. Yes, please.
Well, yeah. Well, not the data, but we do our analysis of the data, and we help organizations put the metrics based on market averages into contracts, because of course, like I explained in the beginning. In the agile world, contracts are usually time material based, which is very bad practice, because what happens if you pay people by the hour is they want to spend more hours instead of less, right? Because they can invoice more. So there's like an inverse mechanism there that impacts your productivity to go down if you don't measure it. And that's why also in a lot of measurements that we do, the baseline measurement of the external vendors is very bad. So they're way less productive than market average. Usually they have way too many people on their team, just invoicing effort hours that maybe they make, maybe not, but they're not productive anyway. And only once you start measuring and put even the KPIs, the metrics that I showed into the contracts, they show improvement. And then especially if you have a blended rate in your contract, and it's even worse, because you start with your procurement, you offer a couple of senior guys for, let's say, blended rate of 100 euro. Then after a year, if you look, there are three juniors there, and they still have a blended rate of 100 euro. And so this increases the margin for the vendor in the hourly rates, but also your productivity goes down. So it's a lose-lose situation for the customer. So output-based metrics very important in agile team contracting. But the whole industry knows very, very little about it. And yeah, we try, of course, to help companies with that.
We're running a little bit over time, but we have one more question here, and I think you could do a quick answer on that. Does number of stories delivered or bugs fixed per sprint considered as functional size? Or should we consider any other measure?
No, the number of stories doesn't say anything, because a story can be very big or very, very, very small. And yeah, it can also be non-functional. It can, should not be, but in practice we see that it happens a lot. In my opinion, functional size, if it's well prioritized, is the only measure possible of business value. And then, of course, it's a question, of course, sometimes you can make a function of three function points, which is very important for the business and generates a lot of business value. And another function of 100 function points is maybe not so important for the organization for when it comes to business value. So the prioritization and the importance of the function points is a different topic, but at least everyone agrees that more functionality, if well prioritized, is better than less functionality.
Okay, thanks a lot, Harold, for this interesting presentation. And we really can see that it was interesting, because we got a lot of questions.
Yeah, so, okay, welcome.
Yeah.